Hi guys, Harry Sunday here, letting you know that there's a apparel company that supports the game that you love. It's called There Is Only One Football.com, guys. They've got all sorts of stuff, from caps, t-shirts, water bottles, all sorts of accessories, even for your mobile phone, all that sporting stuff you can wear anywhere you want to wear it, guys. That's right. And don't forget the website it's on, thereisonlyonefootball.com.
You want to dance, boys? Dance if you like. Cat dance. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
That's it, boys. Keep dancing. Come on, boys. Come on. Where's Carlos? Not doing nothing tonight. Hey.
The cup of life. This is the one. Now is the time. Don't ever stop. We shouldn't know. Gotta be strong. We shouldn't know. Right from the top. And when you feel the heat, the world is at your feet. No one can hold you back if you really want it. I see it in your eyes. You want the cup of life. Not the days, here you're gonna get it. Do you really want it? To me, guys! To me right now, everybody! Hey! Here we go! Ali, Ali, Ali! Go, go, go! We are the people, we are the passion, we are the history, we are footballers, we are the soccer psychos. Oh, I'm the soccer psycho, we've got the other guys as well. Don't forget, guys, it's our way the highway, gentlemen. It's our way the highway tonight, guys. Welcome, of course, right now, guys, to footballers, to Emilio, of course, a trialist, of course, down there at, of course, lower down than us, of course, and from Argentina. Yes, what we're talking about here, from, what's that club called again? Here we go. We're going to find that club as a bleeper for you. But let me tell you right now, guys, it's all happening tonight, guys. This is an amazing story. And, of course, all the way from Italy, the man from Uncle, yes, from Naples, Mr. Angelo. There he is. Oh, and the Socceroo Dad, right? Can't forget the Socceroo Dad, guys. What a story we've got tonight with him. The Socceroo Dad from Adelaide, Mr. Tony Goodwin. Welcome, Tony. Oh, boy. Emilio was trialing, guys. The gentleman there with the glasses and the mo, he's kind of wearing a Argentinian top there right now. What an amazing story. Before we start the show, we want to tell you guys out there how this actually happened and how we knew about this. Now, a few weeks ago, Tony, you and me were at a certain coffee
shop down at Essendon there. We spoke and I said, guys, friends of mine at the shop, I said, of course, Raymond, this is Tony Goodwin and his friend Guy from Adelaide. Of course, Tony's football royalty, some plays for the Socceroos. And the girl said, oh, yes, my boyfriend plays for the – he plays the game. Yeah, he went and trialled at – he plays the game. He went and trialled Boca Juniors. And I said, he must be bloody good, that's for sure. But I tell you what, mate, what an amazing story. Tony, you were there. You heard Amelia speak to you on the phone. Now we got him online, Tony.
Yeah, it was nice, actually, just meeting by chance, just sitting there and having a coffee and a bit of brekkie.
Yes.
And, yeah, just got chatting with a young waitress there. And, yeah, but it's funny because she said, oh, he played for Boca. So the Boca Juniors, they said, oh, yeah, that might be it. Like, what the hell? So that was rather interesting way of just introducing it. But of course, Emilio rang and put him on, and that's where the story went from.
And of course, only for that, amateur, your name is Merv. Do you know that? And she didn't know, Emilio, she didn't know what Boca Juniors meant or what. I said, excuse me, but that's like the Manchester United of bloody, Manchester United, Liverpool of bloody Argentinian football. I said, are you serious? You don't know about them? Oh, my God. Emilio, mate, your journey has been massive. Of course, let's just say that, I mean, I can't believe this. There's that many kids going overseas right now that we know, and Angelo's got quite a few kids, apparently. He's got a few kids in Italy. We'll talk about that very shortly and compare your situation to Angelo's kids who were there, who he's an agent, of course. But, you know, the thing is, we met you at Andy's place on the phone with your girlfriend, Merv, of course. Merv?
Yeah.
That's right. I remember her very well. And, of course, you know, and that's what happened. I was just very surprised and all the things that we said. But how did you apply for this position? I mean, to go on trial, was there some kind of a special way of applying, some kind of thing? And I know we saw your transfer and everything, but how did this happen?
Yeah, I guess it just starts from the story from as a kid, you know, to how I got there, and just the natural scenario of it all. I was working hard from a junior, but it started as grassroots playing, you know, as under sevens at Altona City, mm-hmm. In Melbourne. And from a young age, my family, by coincidence, obviously being Argentinian, I guess background, the soccer was always a passion of ours. So I guess naturally I took it on and I went with it. Obviously it was at the forefront always of my mind as a kid. And, you know, I did my best as a junior through the juniors and how it really got influenced at the time. My father came from Argentina and he was a tiler. And one of his first gigs was with an awesome coach of mine, ended up becoming a coach for 16 years, was Ricardo Tiardo.
Name is familiar. And I've got a story about that to tell you as well in a minute after you mentioned that. I haven't told you yet, but I'll tell you online here. Go on.
Yeah, so obviously... You know, knowing that I was playing and his Danny's father, Ricky, was a coach at the time and had a small bunch of kids that he would coach privately, you know, during the week and mainly on Saturdays and that was a massive influence. He was a super coach. He showed me, like, you know, growing up, like we'd go on Saturdays, you know, 8 years old, 9 years old and Danny would come in the off season, you know. So seeing like a player, you know, at top level, you know, for Australia then was always a you know, an eye opener, you knowing that it was possible. So, you know, I kept at it and persevered, and through the juniors, through Altona City, I kept going higher in Victoria. There never was an opportunity through the junior level through the state league, Victoria, you know, the VIS stuff, that was never interest. I'm not sure that was a, you know, that was a path that never come my way. So I kept playing at the high level of Victoria. Through high school, St. George Cross, and things like that. And what happened was, it was just purely like I look back on it, obviously, you know, I haven't touched on the story in a while. And anyway, at the time when I finished year 12, my family said, you know, you want to go to Argentina? And the idea was only for a holiday, 3 month holiday. And I'm like, yeah, no worries. And at the time, I was obviously under watch with Ricky and his other son was a player manager at the time as well. And he said, why don't you just take your boots and see how you go? Just go. Just, there's nothing to lose, right? And I'm like, oh, I don't know if I'm, you know, I'm not sure if I'm ready for that kind of thing. And anyway, I took my boots and caught up with my family on that side of town in Argentina. I flew over there on my own, and I just went to try. I got arranged a few clubs at a lower division, and through a contact in Argentina, because it's quite open there for kids to go trial at really any club. Like, the system is quite different there. So that got arranged, and I got to trial there. And what happened was, obviously, I got to trial at three of the big clubs, which was Boca Juniors. Another team was Vélez Sarsfield in the Primera Division. And Lanús, which that level was, you know, going as a 17-year-old from Australia, it was, you know, I wasn't prepared. So that was a big step. So I went and took an opportunity at the lower division, Primera B division, like the B league. And one of the clubs, which was founded by Italians 100 years ago, Sportivo Italiano, wanted me to stay under 21 level. Beautiful. So I called home. I called my parents, and said that this is going on over here, and I cancelled my return flight and I ended up staying a year in Argentina.
What an experience, Angelo. That seems very clashed to some of the boys. They're coming out. They want to go overseas, Angelo. They want to come. You've spoken to me at some boys that have actually signed up. Is that right? In Serie C in Italy. Very similar story, Angelo. You know, very similar story.
Well, look, I think it's a very, very, very nice story there from Emilio. It does give me goosebumps because, you know, they are sort of stories that start from nowhere and then they end up being a great reality and, you know, like a dream come true. Now, we've got two kids that we've signed with a Serie C club, Lega Pro, Serie C, which is third division, one of the strongest third divisions in Europe. And Benevento has actually dropped down. Avellino both play Serie A. Mm-hmm. Catania, obviously, with Vince Grella is the vice president. We're in the same competition. And these two kids, one kid, 16-year-old, they're both 16, actually. One is from Port Melbourne.
Mm-hmm.
He did all junior grades over there in Port Melbourne. Then went over to Leicester City, an elite academy there, which is the coach there is Enzo Marasco, who played for Juventus. He's actually the coach of the first team, and they're top of the table, near top. Anyway, these kids have had their development furthered over there in Leicester City, and they both approached me and my management group, which is part of what I do in Italy. I don't do that full time, but, you know, I'm actually involved in a management group, which is connected also with the Catalyst Group in England.
Mm-hmm.
And the Catalyst Group in England is a big FIFA agency. And that's where we sort of linked up, and I do the work in Italy. And of course, we've got at the moment 8 players from Serie A, some from Salernitana who are bottom of the ladder. They want to get rid of some players. But of course, if you get rid of some players, then you've got the chance to offer them other players. But we've got connections now. We're linked with 4 clubs in Spain, four clubs in Germany. With Anderlecht in Belgium. In England, we're involved with Brentford and also Bournemouth, which is owned by Bill Foley, who you know, just announced that he's going to own an A-League club in Auckland. So I think Emilio is a fantastic story because these kids, like the two kids that we signed, one is called Max Prasopoulos from Melbourne, Port Melbourne, and the other kid is Thomas Petrovsky, who actually developed in Rochdale, went over to England, Leicester City, great development. And these kids, they're really well matured. You know, they've got great bodies and they do all the personal training and, you know, in the gym. They've got the scientific background. And, you know, let me tell you, you will hear about these kids because we've got the contacts, like even with Tony Vidmar, who's got the Oli Roos. So the next step will be Oli Roos. Because they're both Australian kids, but that none of these kids got picked up in the A League, which you know, as you know, Harry, and I talk about. There's a lot of kids that come through, like Alessandro Piccardi, who's playing for Parma. He never got picked up by Perth. No. Of course, we all know the story of Volpato.
Yes, Christian. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. I know.
Yeah, it is ridiculous because now Graham Arnold. has actually come back, you know, in times and gone over the, he's come over in Italy, he's gone and watched Alessandro, and now he's picked him in the Spurs. It's the first time he's ever picked him. Volpato, on the other hand, has played for the under-21s in Italy, so I'm not sure whether he can go back and play for the Spurs. But at the end of the day, I don't want to go on about this, but there are problems in Australia with with kids that are being picked up, talent identification, since we got rid of that, you know, the great organisation that we had. I think it was the Tony. You'd be able to help me. What was that? The Institute of Sport.
That's right.
Now, that was a great organisation. We saw lots of kids come through and lots of big stars that went over and played in England. You know, we could name 10, 15 players. And it's a shame that some of these A-League clubs don't pick up players like Inrakunda, for example. Yes. He got picked up. And look, we've seen the results. He's obviously gone over the bigger and better things. You'll be over to Bayern Munich. But I think there's something missing in Australia. This is my final message. There is something missing in Australia that I'm sure there's thousands of kids that don't get picked up.
It's true. And what I'm saying here is that you gave yourself an opportunity over there, Emilio, of course. And the thing is, the ride that you had for a year, and the thing is, what I want to say to you is this, did you meet anyone quite high up? I think you might have met some guys pretty high up in Argentinian football when you went over there. And we're talking a country here, not like Australia, Emilio. We're talking about a country there where the game is number one, and you would have seen fans over there go crazy over their clubs. Mate, just about to die in Argentina. Of course, you know what the crowds are like over there. What did you feel over there, being in a country there where the game is God? Let's say God. Is that right?
Yeah, definitely. It is. It's obviously, you're probably aware of, obviously, you know, Argentina as a country itself economically has been very bad for many, many years. And the only probably the thing that keep that country going is its football, like it always has, right? And it's the emotion it brings, right? And how the country comes together. It's I can't explain it, you know. And obviously, you know, you can go for a holiday there for 2 weeks. You can experience it by living there, you know, and living with the football for a year and experiencing day in, day out what the people feel, and obviously the level of football and how many kids are available, like, is unreal, right? So stadiums like, you know, the Boca Stadium, the fans, 70,000 people every weekend. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter the day, you know. So and the kids are when I got there the first 3-4 months, they were a bit hostile, you know.
Who's this
kind of kid coming over from overseas? But you know, I kind of settled that with the way I played and how I performed. So, and I've stayed friends with many of them, you know, and some of them are playing in Italy at the moment.
Really,
things like that. So, but yeah, the country itself is crazy. You know, it is crazy. You feel it as soon as you step into the place. So, you know, the shops closed. Like, I was there 2010 when all that happened, and it was the World Cup. I think that was Germany. And, you know, I experienced, obviously, I was in Argentina while the World Cup was on.
Gee, what a place to be.
And just that was, you know, was crazy itself.
So the players that I'll bring Tony, the players that you, have they gone to bigger and better things than ones that you met in of course, there in Italy? Angelo may know them if you give a couple of names. Do you remember these guys?
I think they're in, like, they're falling towards, like, this. I think they're in Serie D, C, with Rossiglione United. Rossiglione United.
Yes.
Piotese Calcio. I think they're in the lower division. But obviously, through that year, of under 21 level that I played, you know, that 2010 time, probably one of the, you know, best players I got to play against was Eric Lamella at the time.
Gee.
And he was playing for River Plate, and he was just breaking into the senior team.
Oh,
and I think the next year later, he signed with Tottenham Hotspur. That was always a highlight for me. You know, he was magic.
So basically, you met these. Angelo, go on.
No, I was just going to say Lamella played in Italy as well.
Yeah.
Before he went to, he's a left footer, and he's a very good player. Then he went over to England, and I think he went to Spain as well. So He's still playing. He's still playing because I saw him last year playing in the Europa League. That's a great story. Lamella's a very exciting player, still playing.
Yeah, so that was, you know, through my, you know, I was 17, just finishing school, and, you know, there were things that I wasn't expecting, but, you know, I took it on, and it was a super experience. You know, I got to meet, I think he's the president of, or the chairman of Fiorentina now, Nicolas Burdizzo, at the time in Argentina. I got to meet him, meet a bunch of players that don't play today still, and or coach, or, you know, are involved either way in the game, you know.
Fantastic. So. Tony, questions for Emilio.
Yeah, Emilio, when we were chatting on the phone in Melbourne, you mentioned Melbourne Heart at once. So how did you get to go to there?
So, yeah, that was obviously knowing that I got to stay and play a year in Argentina. That kind of obviously, I guess, at the time, you could say, looking back, opened some eyes. I had a little, I guess, article in the Herald Sun at the time when all that happened. And then through, obviously, getting coached with Thiago, I got arranged with first when I arrived back in Australia after probably 4 weeks. I was at the Central Coast Mariners at the time, 2010, 11, for 4 weeks trial. So Graham Arnold was the coach at the time. So that was arranged with Frank Thiago. He was a player agent at the time. So he's Danny's brother. And we met. So me coming back after, you know, I didn't see my family for a year. The last time was 3 weeks after I finished VCE 12. I got on a plane. I did all that year with football. I came back 3 weeks later. I was in a little meeting at the lobby of the Radisson Hotel with Frank Thiago and Graham Arnold with the Central Coast Mariners talking about a possible trial.
Fantastic. Now, let me just say to you now, this seems to be like a movie called Goal. What I'm hearing here is like that movie called Goal, because I've seen it that many times, mate. You know how they treated the poor boy, you know, came from America, Mexican boy, and they basically put him on the ground and they treated him like shit, tripped him over, stuff like that. I bet you it happened to you. I bet you somebody was picking on you and say, who's this little raunchy, raw rat little guy from Australia? What is he doing here? He's not a footballing nation. What were they doing to you? They must have had a go at you for sure.
Yeah, of course. You know, upon arriving, you know, I had the nickname Kanguru, which means kangaroo.
Oh, no, kangaroo. Kangaroo.
You know, so that kind of stuck, and in the end, it became just as mates. But yeah, there was a bit of push and shove. You know, I had to, you know, state a bit of my presence with some strong tackles. You know, a bit of the Australian way.
Yes,
that some of the plays are shown here. So and in the end, let the football you know, decide. And in the beginning, yeah, the first 3 months was rough to adjust, especially from the Australian game. And, you know, obviously I understood Spanish. I wasn't super fluent, and I got fluent as I was there. And so it was difficult to understand, you know, the coach's directions, obviously, at times, because those Spanish words I often didn't hear at home, right? It was just your general term. So as I got all that, obviously, was a learning curve and in itself. So, yeah. But, yeah, there was always a couple of players, probably till this day, that, you know, didn't like that I was an Aussie that was there.
Oh, I've got Angelo, the boys you've got there as well, are they copying something as well there? Like, the boys you've got there in Syria C or Chi, whatever, are they copying, you know, they're Australian boys with European backgrounds and whatever. Are they copying anything like them, these guys as well in Italy? They must be copying something. They have to be.
I've got a couple of things to say. I think Emilio, don't get offended if they call you Kanguru, because when Craig Johnston went over to Liverpool, they used to call him Roo.
Oh, yep.
So if you read his story and the book, and he said it many times, you know, the first, because, you know, he came from Australia, they called him Roo. And even on the pitch, for the rest of his career, he was called Roo. So I think Kanguru is a compliment. Yeah, but... going back to your question, the two lads,
yes.
I can tell you a true story. One of the kids, Prosopoulos, who was from Port Melbourne, he started training, and of course it's very hard, like Emilio was saying, the first thing you need to do is make friends. And I think that Tony would agree as well with Craig. You know, once you go over to another country like Saudi Arabia or England or whatever, wherever you go, you're a stranger. Now, one of the kids, Max Prostopoulos, after about 2 weeks, you know, they all the other kids that are gunning for positions, they saw him as a talent. And of course, one of the nights I was there, he was on the bench, and the coach called one of the guys to come off, one of the other guys to bring on Max Prostopoulos, the stranger. And that guy took his shirt off and chucked it on the ground.
Ooh, gee.
Didn't give it to him. Oh. So it was a pretty bad impression, pretty bad thing for Max, who's only 16. But then, of course, we spoke to him about that. And it's just a competition, you know. Like, people get threatened by talent. And Max was fantastic. He's a great kid off the park as well. We spoke to him. We said, look, it's just jealousy. It's competition. And, of course, that kid, we went to the club and said, this thing is unacceptable. So we went right to the top. To the president, the CEO, and this kid got reprimanded.
Oh, gee.
So it was an Italian kid who had been there since under-15s, and we're talking about under-19s, Primavera, which is the next step, just below the Serie C first team. And anyway, look, just because, you know, I think Emilio mentioned the rule, when Aurelio Vidmar's got a great story, but all the guys that go overseas that try and get into the team, the first team and the first 11, there's always that competition, the jealousy, the backstabbing, you know, and it's really tough to get to the top. That's why I honestly compliment Craig Goodwin.
Yes.
Because Craig Goodwin comes from a country that you know, they still consider as third world, you know, but Craig is a very talented player. He's an excellent footballer. And I think that, you know, now if you get to the top, you know, where management is a little bit different, you know, the president and the coach, they manage things a little different now. It's no longer this thing about the coach thumping on the blackboard. It's all about mind games. I think that most coaches now, like Ange Postecoglou, you know, like Guardiola, let's look at Spalletti, they're all, they know that they're talking to people that have done schooling, well educated. So it's all about getting into the mind of the players, and they manage this sort of thing that I saw and that Emilio saw in Argentina. They manage it differently. They manage it differently so well that you got to make group. The first thing you got to do, you can be the best player in the world, but if you don't get in, you don't get on with your mates, you're going to be sitting on the bench.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, unless you're a Maradona, you're a Messi, or, you know, you're one of these players, you know, Ronaldo, that you go over there. But even Ronaldo, we know the story that's been well publicised, Tony, when he was over to Manchester United. I mean, the coach never liked him from the first day, and you know, because he was an individual, and he never made group at Manchester United. This is the second time he went over, you know. And I think he was outed. They got rid of him, you know. And you know, he was very sad because obviously he had a great story. He started this football at Manchester United when Sir Alex Ferguson was there, but. You know, it's an excellent point that Emilio made. That's a very tough road, and may I congratulate him.
Give it a go. Now, let me just say, what I will say is this. You know, you've come from Australia. You've gone to Argentina. Mate, we're not playing enough games in this country for a season, of course. Mate, how was it over there when you played over there and you said to yourself, oh, the training is so different. There's more training. There's things happening. We're talking about different techniques of training. What did you find so different? Was it more harder training for sure? Was there something that you found very different?
Yeah, of course. I was probably, you know, from obviously learning and understanding from you know, my dad influenced me as well, and obviously the coach that here, I knew that obviously Argentina was, you know, and obviously just the national team, you know, growing up and watching them in the World Cup and all those things, I knew that it was a powerhouse and that, you know, that it's going to be amazing. And it was I had a few stressful injuries, but, you know, five times a week. So here was coming from, like, growing up was, what, at the club two nights a week, and anything was extra, yourself or anything private, right?
Yeah.
So 5 days a week, Monday to Friday, and obviously then the games on the weekend, which were sometimes mostly, home or nationally. So we'd get on the bus, little double-decker, or the double-decker bus as a team, and go 3 days prior if it was an interstate game, and travel all together. But the training itself, we get to the club 8:30 in the morning, and it's the soccer be so important that the soccer clubs, like the schooling, can be arranged around the soccer training period. Right, so you can go to training and still go to school in the afternoon and have that arrangement. So the club's trained in the morning, 8:30, and some days, depending on what games, what weekends the games fell on, we try and set twice a week, twice a day, twice a day, five times a week, in the afternoon as well. A lot of ball work, a lot of ball work. The running factor, was changed a lot here growing up. Every club I went to, warm up guys, 5 laps, right?
Oh my God.
And that was a big difference. Everything, the club that I, the coach that I had there, was a lot of ball work as a warm up. It was different. The tactical theory about it. The game was not as physical, but it was a lot faster. I had to adjust to the pace of the game as well. And I slotted in quite well as a defensive midfielder there. I guess I incorporated a bit of that Australian influence, being a bit more physical and being good with the ball, which helped me in my development through that year.
Absolutely amazing. Tony?
Yeah, one for Angela, actually. On the agent side of things, years and years ago, obviously, when Craig was with going to Palace in England, to get a clearance, obviously, you've got to be 18. Can they leave earlier if they hold a passport for that country?
Yes, definitely. Now, you brought up a good point because both parents of Prosopoulos is from Melbourne and also Petrosky, who's from Sydney, both parents had to move over to Italy. Now, Prosopoulos was easy enough because he had a Greek passport. Mm. And, of course, under FIFA rules, if you're under 18, you have to be accompanied by a parent, 100%. There's no other way. FIFA will not allow it. Petrosky, because he's North Macedonia, we had a few problems with him because obviously they're not part of Europe. And Tony, to answer your question, it was difficult, but we managed to get residency because obviously the kid was going to be signed by the club. And of course, big reason he had to be accompanied by his dad. So we got the residency, but we've got a visa for 1 year. For example, and in that year, he can actually, his dad has to actually establish citizenship. And, until he's 18, that's the way forward, But it's not that easy. It's not that easy. I found something that was a little bit different when North Macedonia, who's not part of Europe, the difficulties with Italy, signing the lad. But we actually managed to get through it through lawyers, and of course we got good legal advice, and that's how we got him through. But that's an excellent point, Tony, because that's the way it is.
So basically,
People think that players could just get up and go, but I always remember saying that the parents had to move over when they were younger. Mm. But I remember when Craig was 12, we went back to holiday to England for a holiday. And I just set up with Palace, it was my hometown club. I said, look, we're not interested in the trial. You must get thousands of requests. We just want to have a training session to work out whether he's up to the standard of your under-12s. And as it turns out, he was. And they said they wanted to see him back when he was 15. But the guy in the room, he said, oh, look, he said, you're born here. And I said, yes. He said, make sure he's got a passport. It'll make your trip a lot easier, which was, really good advice at the time.
Of course.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely, the side that a lot of parents in Australia, let's talk about Australia, don't understand, they don't know, because they can think their kids are talented, they can just get up on a plane and go and sign for a club because they're talented. No, there's legal and bureaucracy, the documentation that you need to prepare and you need to do it properly. Otherwise, if the player signs, and he plays all year, that team can get their points taken away.
Yeah, and the other one too that came up was which of course Craig was signed by the Palace as under 15s. And then when they got the contract out, we got the birth certificate out, and they said, hang on, he's 16. We said, no, he's not, he's 15, he's born in December. We said, no, our year goes from August to September. Ooh. That's a big fall for Australian players, because our system operates here from a calendar year. Their system operates on a footballing year. So if your kid's born after August, they fall into the next age bracket. So any kids going overseas, they've got to beware of that sort of fall, because it came unstuck. You know, he had a contract and all of a sudden it was void. Jeez.
That's amazing.
What the hell? Now, yeah. Amazing.
Emilio, amazing. You didn't have that problem. And being an Argentinian background, what was it like getting in there? That's the thing. The boys are talking about foreigners, of course, other kids in different backgrounds, and of course Max being in Greek, at the Greek passport. You had the Australian passport. How well was it? Were you taken in there, basically moving there for a year? What was it like? You were able to do that much easier?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, back it was a while ago now, and I guess, you know, I'm not sure if it can be done today, but obviously, you know, in regards to how I stayed there a year, both my parents were Argentinian, born over there. I was born here. I have an Australian passport. And obviously the club wanted me to sign. I turned 18 as I arrived. I had to wait for that. And obviously all that paperwork or side of things was done in Australia, right? All I know is it got sent to me between the clubs. And obviously Frank Tiardo in Australia on the ground here, contacting with the FFV. But how I stay there is, so Uruguay is 1 hour boat ride away from Argentina. So you had to leave the country. I was able to stay there as a tourist every 6 months, I think, or three. And I left to Uruguay for the weekend three times in that year, and I got to stay there the year.
So you found a loophole where the others found it very difficult, like, of course, why Angelo's telling me this stuff too. Now, I'll bring Tony back in a minute too. Now, the club, you also played for an Italian – now, you played for the Italian club a lot, Deportivo Italiano, is that right? You played for you played for them a lot longer, is that right? So how long did you play for them for?
So I mainly stayed there. So the first few weeks was the trials, and I was there probably the most of the year. So
fantastic.
You know, 10 months, 11 months, probably something like that, was with that entire club. You know, and those are the boys that I know that are, two of them are in Italy, and it was under 21 level at the time. So how it was mixed was the senior team was in the B division. The under 21s was mixed with the Primera A. So the under 21s was in a big league mixed with River Plate, Boca Juniors, divided into two.
Unbelievable. So how do they look at the juniors there, the development of the juniors? It's very different. Well, you played juniors in Australia, right? What was the difference there? Were you playing under 21s? What was the difference that you saw in the junior development? Even you might have seen other age groups. What was the development there like there?
Well, first, you know, like the amount of clubs. The amount of clubs there are, right? Every town, it's like here in Melbourne, imagine, you know, Altona, Point Cook had a stadium.
Jeez.
That's how it is. Literally 40,000. Oh. And then there are the main clubs, the smaller clubs, stadiums everywhere. So there was the amount of opportunity for kids, and the amount of kids, especially kids on the street, that, you know, the a lot of the stories of Argentinian players, you know, come from nothing and made their way to be stars they are today. But the club, you know, there's the massive stadium. They have their, you know, they'll call it in Spanish, the sede, like their, you know, where they have their presentations and the kiosk of the club, where the players can go on, just say on the week, during the week, and they can get noted. You know, I want to come to a trial. They got it in the notary. They write their name. Mm. They come and they build the list and they pick a day for the trial. Like Boca Juniors that time was about 120 kids.
Ooh,
and the coaches go cutting, you know, go cutting, and that's how you know, I saw it. You know, it wasn't like here when the A-League started growing up, it was a big, you know, ooh, the A-League was, you know, it was quite closed off. It wasn't as an open door. I know they had to get it off. That was my experience, my take on it, you know, like obviously I know they wanted to get the league up and running and get players from overseas, and at the time, you know, they didn't really care about development. That's ridiculous. So, but the difference in the amount of kids and the passion for the game. It's hard to describe, you know. It's really hard.
So these guys are looking for homegrown players and they want their own homegrown players. So basically what happens is that they want their own players to develop and put them in the big league in Argentina, of course. That's the thing. Where you're saying to me the A-League wasn't looking, they were looking for ready-made players at the beginning. They weren't really looking for juniors. That's not really good there, Tony, what you're hearing as well, huh? I think, Tony, what do you think of that?
Yeah, well, it basically was. I know there was a situation when Craig missed out on that Palace gig and then the Inverness one through just by the fact that their first team got relegated, which culled the academy, basically. Mm. So, again, he had a contract and he missed out. But my cousin we were staying with received a message from Ray Richards in Australia. I said, how the hell do you know Ray Richards? So I went to school with him. In England, which I thought was freaking amazing, before Ray came out to Australia. And Ray was made aware of him, but he got in contract with Laurie McKenna. Mm. And we got a message to say either Laurie McKenna or Alex Tobin would be contacting you when you return to Australia, which didn't actually eventuate. Mm. We're not sure why, but I know I did see Laurie years later at Donald Campbell's retirement, and I actually asked him. He said, "Bloody hell, I do remember that." He said, "Look, all our players were by recommendation to start with, and we just had to follow off on them." And he said, "God knows why we didn't follow up on Craig. I wish we bloody had, but you know." But that's the way it was. Every club basically started very quickly, as Angelo would know with Adelaide. But luckily enough, the majority of all our players were locals, and that's the way they wanted it to be. And it was bloody amazing that first year. So it's a tough gig. It's very hard. But I guess one of your highlights, Emilio, was, I guess, being in Argentina, you got to meet the old national team for Argentina.
Yeah, you know, there was a, you know, it's a, you know, I've got the shirt here with me, all signed by the boys, you know.
Oh, gee.
Meeting Messi at the time, so he was quite young, you know, 2010. So, yeah, that was special. So yeah, Carlos Tevez was in that team there, and that was the generation that, you know, I grew up watching. Even before that, you know, I grew up watching Batistuta. You know, I got to meet Batistuta throughout the years as well. But yeah, the national side was actually, you know, probably maybe on the phone we didn't talk enough, but I met the national side in 2008 in Australia.
Boy.
In the Langham Hotel. So that's how we met them. My parents were there, and we got to meet them individually, and that was a special moment for me that I'll always you know, cherish. And I still haven't yet to frame the shirt. I've got a few shirts to frame over the years, but yet to get to it. But yeah, I've got it there stashed away.
And also, Angelo, what Emilio was saying as well, the kids, 120 kids trialing and stuff like that. How your boys, they've trialed their course, and now how many kids, you would have seen more, a couple of hundred or even more, Angelo. How many would you have seen if this is 120 in one of the clubs there in Argentina? How many would you have been to this sort of stuff?
Yeah, well, I travelled to Milan and in Verona as well, and there's hundreds of kids, you know.
Oh,
I love to say, the time that I was there was hundreds of kids that, you know, like, and a lot more kids trialing for the same position. You know, obviously the competition is very tough here. Argentina was a market that Italy kept going over there to search for players. And I think in Argentina, it's the sort of market that, you know, players come over to Italy for a quite reasonable price. You know, it's not because they're inferior. They're actually very, very talented. You know, but they come over because of the, I suppose Emilio touched on it before, you know, the wages they get over there is a lot lower than they would get in Europe. And of course, if you're a very, very talented player, you come over in Europe and you get a handsome sort of contract. Now, England is the same, you know, the big European markets, you know. And it was always a fishing pond, you know, for Italy. It is still now. I mean, there's a lot of talented Argentinians in Italy playing in lower grades. Whether they come through or not remains to be seen. Brazil as well. And the market's totally changed now. And as we know, Italy has been has been quite underachieving, you know, as far as the national team, you know, not qualifying in the last two World Cups. And the main reason was because they didn't look in their backyards for the kids that were coming through. I mean, you know, Milan last week, you know, they actually introduced a 15-year-old to play in the first 11, you know, against Fiorentina, Camrado, Francesco Camrado, who's only 15, played his first game a couple of weeks ago. And I think I'm going into a different topic here, but, you know, it's all to do with the youth and development, and Italy has actually changed their direction, taken a new direction in looking into the Italian lower leagues for the youth. For example, Tourist last about 2 weeks ago got 10 kids got selected between the under-15s, under-16s and under-17s for the national team. So in Serie C, which is the third division, and also the fourth division, clubs are forced to play the younger kids.
Gee,
okay, you're talking about kids born 2004, 5, 6 and 7 must play. You must have a quota of 4 players in Serie D, and Serie C is the same. And I think that's a great rule because, you know, Italy, at the end of the day, has paid the price. They haven't qualified the last two World Cups because they got too many strangers. We say strangers with all due respect, you know, like with equal opportunities and all that, you know, players from other countries, right, playing in their team. But that is changing at the moment. Italy is looking more for youth, talented youth in their own backyard in Italy. Italian-born players, you know, coming through. Pafuta is the other one at Udinese. He was actually introduced to the national team by Mancini, the outgoing national coach. He was only 16, played his first game for Italy. And, of course, Spain does it very well. We all know that Spain has lots of young, you know, young players, teenagers playing for the national team. I think that Luis Enrique did a great job there introducing him. And now, of course, Spain is always at the top of the tree, you know, as far as the talent. Emilio Scuri is amazing. But, you know, Argentina is still a country where lots of other countries look for talent because they've got millions of players that are so talented.
Now, Emilio, what I want to say is this to you. Were you in Buenos Aires itself? You were in the city in yourself living there or one of the suburbs?
Yeah, I was in the suburbs. So from Buenos Aires, probably half an hour, 40 minutes. I was living at my auntie's place, you know, that's, God rest her soul, she's no longer with us, but I lived with my dad's sister, my auntie and uncle.
Yes, yes.
We're about, you know, in a town called Lomas de Zamora, which is, about 40 minutes from from Buenos Aires. So about half an hour from the Boca Stadium,
yes.
You know, the Boca La Bombonera, which I got the chance to visit as well. I was there and watch a game and feel the stadium shake and the concrete shake.
Oh, my God.
Jumping up and down and being at the right to the end of the game with the police and the rubber bullet shooting.
Oh,
and the
my God. Here we go.
Running to fight, the smoke, gas, all that. Mate. I experienced all that kind of thing.
How much I would want to experience that, my God, mate. The religion of the game. You know where I'm getting at here now, huh? You're telling me all this stuff. Here I am. All of a sudden, you're saying this stuff. You're living in the suburb, one of the city. I'm thinking, is this going to be the same as the favelas in Brazil where the kids are making balls with bloody stockings and filling them up with bloody... Did you go around? Did you see something like that? Can you explain the kids the skills you saw with the way that they were actually... what were they doing? Making balls with stockings and filling them up with bloody newspapers? What were they doing? That's what we want to know.
Yeah, I mean, like 2010, probably, you know, I think there was a bit developed, I think, by then. So, you know, there were the street kids here, the favelas that you talk of.
Yes.
Obviously in Brazil, they're called favelas. In Argentina, they call them villas.
Ah.
And obviously, where we lived, you drive or walk 3 kilometers,
yep.
And it's there. It's a place that you don't go at night, you don't visit at night. You know, it's like the real hoods of Argentina, where it's a lot of poverty scene, and obviously you do see the only thing that can bring happiness to a young boy or girl, you know, in Argentina, is
yes.
kicking the ball around. So you know, and that's where it begins due to the distress of the, you know, the nation and the families, yes, and the poverty of the entire country really is what drives a lot of the players that, you know, are talented to get their families out of the rut, right? So that's a lot of the stories, especially from Argentina, that, you know, I've witnessed and know firsthand. You know, but obviously, you know, the opportunity was given to me, you know, being born in Australia. I was very grateful, you know, for my parents' support, you know, to get me to, you know, while I was young, through my juniors, to be able to get there and have that experience at the end of the day. And yeah, the kids, that's where it starts, Harry, you know, like you see them on the street. That's and then sometimes it takes, you know, I've heard stories while I'm there, it takes
exactly
just, you know, there's so many clubs that a coach can be driving down the road and there's a story like, hey, mate, look, do you want to come for a kick?
Oh,
and they sign him up, right? So
unbelievable. So they go to these areas and see these kids playing on the streets, even on the beaches in Argentina. You've been to the beaches in Argentina as well, where they're playing with a ball. You're saying these massive skills, and they don't want to get involved. They just like what they're doing. Is that right? Oh, boy.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, the beach is about... I was there for the summer, so yeah. From Buenos Aires, it's about 4 hours away, but yeah, I got to experience the summer while I was there on the off-season, you know, that year before, prior just returning to Australia. And, yeah, you know, obviously it's more relaxed. There's more of a fiesta on the beach, but there's always the soccer ball around, the volleyball nets, you know, and then, you know, that kind of, like, you know, what you kind of think of Brazil, that Copacabana thing is kind of very similar.
I'm going to ask Tony, and of course, can we start? Of course, Angelo and Tony, and of course Kenny Wilson. I wish he was on the night, but the thing is, we should be doing a tour of these places where there's these kids. What Emilio's saying, and just say, hang on, what's your name? Let's get a team together there, or some development thing happening. Tony, what do you think, mate? These stories are just amazing. We don't see enough of this, Tony, do we? No.
Well, one thing I think we learned with Craig's journey, yes, was, I'm trying to remember who actually said it. I'll think of it in a minute. But what it was basically, you don't know who's watching.
Mm.
And it was so true. I think it might have been Aki Anonis at Oakley. He was saying how so many different scouts watch the games from the BPL, mm, including the under-21s, and we were quite shocked that I thought he was exaggerating, and he wasn't, because when we were there, we were pointing them all out. But there was a case where Craig was supposed to be playing a first-team game for Oakley, and he got gastro, and he couldn't play. So the following week, Arthur Pappas said, come back through the reserve. So he did, and Craig absolutely turned it on. I mean, he just had a game from heaven. And in the stands, a guy comes down, and he said, oh, who's that number eight? And he said, too late, mate. Melbourne Heart have already got him. It was Miron Blyberg.
Oh, my God, mate.
I remember when he was in England, he was playing with my cousin's sons. He had like an outdoor, it's like indoor but played outdoor, like on a big tennis court type situation. And they talked Craig into playing for that team that night. Anyway, he was ripping it up. The nutmeg and a lot of players and everything. And this guy comes over and he said, where are you from? I said, I'm from Australia. He said, I'm from Sheffield United. But I said, too late, mate. He's already from Crystal Palace, you know. But you don't know who's watching. And that's what I say to kids now. Put in your best performances, because you just don't know. It might be a crowd there, but in that crowd could be someone who's looking for just you. And it is we've seen it so many times. Craig was involved. I've seen it with other kids. I guess now that the eyes are opened years later, it actually stands out like the proverbial. And it's true. And yes, it just, long as every stage you sing on, there's someone listening. And you just got to do it at the right time. And there isn't a lot of luck.
Yeah.
But I was going to ask you too, like, at what point when you're in Argentina or overseas, did you realize it was either not going to work, or did it come down to a finance thing that it couldn't work? What was your story there coming back to Australia?
Yeah, that was obviously, it was mainly, you know, for a development path. You know, that was the focus, being at under 21 level. So I just stayed there, obviously, by that holiday visa way, training and playing that season. And obviously at the end, you know, I couldn't stay any longer due to, you know, those financial aspects. That year of development, you know, I guess served me well, and I grew it from it, and it gave me a bit of a a light at the end of the tunnel to, you know, try and have some sort of a career in Australia.
Mm.
You know, because that, you know, at the time I was told, you know, that was, that's what, you know, needed to happen to be seen here.
Fantastic.
You know, so if you, you know, if you play at Essendon Royals, Stage One, if you were to play at Werribee City Premier League, it wasn't enough, you know. That was what I was told in 2010, which, you know, the A-League was quite new, and it was the year also, I think that was the year the youth development, that youth team, that lower division got started, I think. Because when I ended up going to Hart, sorry that I missed that, touching on Hart, so I was 4 weeks at Central Coast Mariners, and obviously that didn't work out. You know, physically, there was no youth squad. Obviously, at 19, I'm quite a slim, you know, guy, especially at 19. I've put on a bit of size now, but I went straight into the senior squad of the Mariners, you know, and then there were the likes of, you know, Daniel McBreen was there. And he was massive when I walked into that team. You know, he'd push my shoulder like that, like I was like a little twig, you know. So I felt that big physicality, a big issue at the time. And, you know, my intentions were, amazing. You know, my intentions coming back was like, oh, the youth team is going to start. You know, that probably, you know, would have been perfect, you know, kind of the idea.
But that
never eventuated. And
yes.
I came back from Central Coast and was on another three-week trial with Melbourne Heart, which they didn't have the youth team at the time. And that was with John Van Chip as coach.
Oh, yes.
I think the assistant coach was Ante Milicic. And I never dealt with John Van Chip directly. It was all with Ante, and that just, I did the 3 weeks there. My dad came to watch, you know, I thought I did well, and that's all. And, you know, that was the journey really. And I ended up falling back into the NPL or Victoria, and that was pretty much it.
Angelo, what we said about with, of course, where, Emilio was living and he'd seen the kids around. Is that happening in Italy at all? When you drive around, of course, you're going to be in the area. You see kids kicking the ball around, doing things, and they're mucking around instead of watching, getting on the iPads and all that sort of stuff. Is that happening at all in Italy? Are kids getting around doing stuff like that?
No, look, that's absolutely correct. You know, in Italy, it's just a football world, you know, like Argentina. And I was just listening to Tony and Emilio, both something very interesting is the fact that, you know, when the kids are underage, like under 18s, Emilio mentioned that he went back to Australia. There was no youth league, and we all know about the career path in Australia where, you know, like for many years there was no youth league, no AIS. And I think when he got back, he was very unlucky because, you know, we mentioned about Polpato, we mentioned about Ciccati not getting picked up, and perhaps Emilio could have been picked up if there was the right talent identification path, the pathway. Just to answer your question also, Harry, is the fact that these kids that I signed with tourists, Serie C, which is the division, you know, it's a big investment for the parents because they're signing a contract. Mm. They can't sign a professional contract where they get picked in the first 25 and they're earning money. They're actually earning no money, and it's a greater investment for the parents. But, you know, We obviously advise the parents as well. We're a great consulting of the parents, you know, to say whether it's the right decision or not. Because living in another country for a year, you've got to rent, you know, and you've got to pay the rent. Then you have to pay everything else. The only thing that the kid is sponsored, and he gets sort of everything is paid for the kid, you know, like from the club, where he goes and eats at a restaurant which is sponsored by the club. But as Emilio's story is great, but not just because he's made it over there and is very humble, you know, to know that he was at Boca Juniors and all that sort of thing, but also because it must have been a great investment for his dad that believed in him. And then, of course, he stayed at his auntie's house and uncle's house. That would have been a big saving, okay? Because, you know, otherwise, and that's a great, that shows great determination.
It does.
Because if you haven't got the support, you're not going to make it, whether you're, like Craig Goodwin, beautiful story. I never knew these things about Craig Goodwin. Obviously at Crystal Palace, where obviously Carl Veit played there as well. We all know that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but it's a great investment. Yeah.
Of course.
Tony would know. I mean, you know, right now Tony has the great satisfaction of seeing Craig at the back of winning
the best player in Australia,
mm-hmm.
and playing in Saudi Arabia, getting lots more money, is a great reward for a kid that has actually worked so hard. And I'm not just saying it because Tony is listening, but, you know, I really think this is about Craig. And also Emilio. Emilio, that's a very humble story, you know, that you stayed at your auntie's and, you know, big sacrifices, you know, from you and the parents. And, you know, Harry, this is all because we don't have the career path in Australia. Look, I'm sure, I'm dead certain that there are hundreds and thousands of kids that are very talented, but they don't get promoted to the structure with the A-League club. Let's hope that the B-League or, you know, the second tier competition is a step forward, you know, for these types of kids, you know. We might have a younger age group, you know, younger kids playing for the second tier. Let's hope so.
Exactly. Now, let me say, before we finish tonight, you had a few players that actually had gone to the A-League. They were with you. We spoke about that before. Rashid Mahazi. Rashid Mahazi, you must know him quite well. You were there at the same time as him. Is that right?
Yeah. So he was, I think, at the time for his story. So I just met him playing, you know, at club level and then being at that River Plate Academy.
Yep.
That was held in Dandenong, Victoria at the time. And once I left, that story started. And then I heard, obviously, through social media and that he was coming to trial with River Plate via that academy. So he ended up staying a year in Argentina as well, but signing with a different club. I came back and he continued to stay for, I think, a year and a half. And that was his story. And then he ended up coming into the A-League and falling into Melbourne Victory.
Unbelievable.
But, he did well, you know. I know, I think he had a tricky moment when his father passed and through his football journey, but he did really well, you know, and he was a top player for Victory, and he ended up playing, I believe, in Korea. He went towards the end. I saw him last week, actually, at the I was with him and Merv at the game, at the Bangladesh Socceroos game.
Yes, we were there too. Me and Tony were there. Let me ask you, this is the thing, you're going to have a lot of kids watching this show, because I've actually advertised it, so check this out, because this could be a different pathway rather than Europe. Now, what would you say to any kids saying themselves, "What I don't want to go to Europe, I want to go somewhere else"? What is the, how would you explain the path in, this is a good one, how would you explain the path in South America? Of course, Argentina being a premier football nation there, and they're probably one of the biggest besides Brazil. How would you talk to a kid and say, give it a go in Argentina and South America? How would you talk? How would you say that to them?
Yeah, that's, no one's ever asked me that. Talking South America for a kid in Australia, I don't think I've personally heard another story myself here in Australia. So going to South America, and I know the challenges and the amount of kids there are. But, it's going to be based on, you know, how hungry you are, how passionate you are, how determined, you know, how much sacrifices you're willing to make through the sport. A lot of talent is a big part of it. And especially, you know, comparing it to a nation like Argentina, there's a lot of natural talent. You know, there's boys that don't need a train and they're like, you know, magicians on the ball. So that's a difficult answer. You know, you'd have to be very determined, I guess that's why it's probably hard to answer, because, and it's probably clear, is why you see a lot of boys from Australia traveling to Europe. It's a much easier path, I think, because, I probably can't answer that, you know.
Might have done it the hard way by going to Argentina, where we're talking a country that is like, you know, the way they play the game, the religion, the people, they go crazy. They probably kill people in the streets. I shouldn't be saying that, but I know that happens over there. But, mate, that's true, Angelo. I know what it's all about in Brazil. Was it one game that it was the Gold Cup? I tell you this one. I don't know whether you were around at that time, but apparently when Australia beat Argentina in the Gold Cup in 1988, you remember that, Tony? And you remember that too? And Charlie Yankos went berserk with that goal.
Charlie Yankos.
Remember that? Charlie Ancos' goal?
Yeah,
and I don't know if I Emil- mate, that goal, what and then Paul Wade scoring, and he says it wasn't offside. He said it was offside. Honestly, that day, they said in Argentina they're calling a state of emergency. Is that what it's like over there? State of emergency? The national team lost overseas to Australia. My God, man. That was funny.
Of course. I'm sure probably you saw, you know, footage of the recent, you know.
Ooh, mate.
The winning last year, winning the World Cup.
Yes.
You know, the millions of people blocking the freeway, you know. It is like that. It is like that, you know. I always tell people, you know, it's a fantastic place. And, you know, it's a once-in-a-lifetime experience, you know, going to places like, you know, sacred places like La Bombonera, you know, El Monumental, River Plate ground. And it is like that. It is like that, you know. The shops close for the important games, the siesta, you know, when the World Cup's on. That is all well and true there. That is it. The nation stops. The
Unbelievable, nation stops, mate.
For the game.
So what happens if they'd lost the World Cup? What would the streets be like?
Yeah, they'll be lucky they won because
I heard they break things in the streets, they fight with the coppers, they riots and everything. That doesn't happen, like, Angelo and Italy doesn't. No, because I mean they haven't made the World Cup Italy, but do they do that with teams?
I just want to make a point there, but that Emilio probably was in Argentina when the Socceroos, you know, 12 months ago, played against Argentina, the Socceroos. And I remember coming on your show, Harry, and saying, because, you know, we got lots of publicity from here, the fact that the Socceroos, because of this this fanatical sort of wave in Argentina, the Socceroos got a tremendous promotion. Mm. You know, all the front pages of in Argentina, Emilio, you'll be able to confirm this, you know, they spoke so highly of the Socceroos, the fact that they were such a challenge, you know, because obviously we could have drawn the game, the death. In the 90th minute, 88th minute, I can't remember. Mm. But it was the young kid that came on. You'd be able to help me, Tony. Sorry?
Definitely.
He could have chipped the keeper, but he hit it straight to the keeper. But, Emilio, you'd be able to bring this through. That was only recent, about 4 months ago. The Socceroos got a tremendous promotion, didn't they?
They did, of course. I had my family message me. You gave me some heart attacks, you know. I had my family, you know, Australia did very well, and you know, they came at us and all that. I go, I was, you know, that day it was a tough day, you know. I'm on the fence there, obviously being born here and that, but it was a fantastic game, and obviously seeing such, like a player like Qual to come on and create that atmosphere and that opportunity in such high level. Pressure, all that kind of thing. It was amazing, and it was on the news. It was all over the papers. You know, Australia took it all the way against the champions. You know,
unbelievable, mate. I tell you what, we could talk. Yes, Angel, we could talk forever. This stuff. Argentina is the centre of the universe in the game, and Brazil. I mean, you can't go wrong with talking about Argentinian or Brazilian soccer. And of course, you know yourself. What happens if a Brazilian goes to trial in Argentina? What, how they treat him? You've probably seen this, huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably much better now. I'm sure it's still deep down. But yeah, you know, that was, you know, especially like, you know, I didn't encounter a Brazilian at the time, but, you know, from Paraguay, you know, people, it's always someone from another country. It's very hostile.
I know what you're saying.
Where the football's gone, you know, fantastic is with the racism today. You know, I feel like that's taken away, you know, a lot out of the game, so that's fantastic. But when I was there, you know, it was a bit different, you know, 15 years ago now. And especially players, you know, from other countries, Colombia, Paraguay, that come into the teams and that they always got a bit of, you know, a bit of nasty words here and there. And the same here. Like, you know, on a different level, right? The juniors, you know, there was, you know, a lot of ethnic clubs growing up, you know, Melbourne Knights, you know, South Melbourne, all different nationalities. So there was a bit of that growing up through school. You know, I was Argentinian, so, you know, everyone was a bit jealous that I was from Argentina. Mm-hmm.
We know. I think Tony and of course Angelo would know these things. We could go further back with this stuff. We don't want to go there. But Guy, I tell you what an amazing journey you had with the game. Honestly, mate, to get over there and actually, guys, if you guys out there And everybody listening tonight, please share this one, because this is an amazing story where a development, a junior goes to Argentina, gets over there, and you want to show your kids, and if this is a training thing for kids where they want to go overseas to play the game differently and take a different pathway. This is a different pathway that we're showing tonight for everyone and the families and everybody. Thank you very much for coming on, Emilio. Of course, Tony, and of course, all the way from Italy, thank you very much. It's early morning or afternoon there. Angelo, thank you for joining us. Thanks, guys, on Footballers. We'll see you guys. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you, guys. We'll see you guys next week as well. Don't worry, guys. It's all party time with Footballers again next week. Thank you for joining me, Angelo, Tony, and Emilio. What a great story, mate. Thank People you. Are going to share thank this around. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Footballers was live from South Bank, Australia. Hey. Clap your hands, boys. You can't hit me, boys, until you see the replays, okay? Thanks, everyone. Hey, guys. Thank you. Good night, guys. Thank you. Hup, hup. Check it out. Hup. Feel it. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Hup. Hey. Thanks, Emilio. Thank you. Feel it. Hup. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Check it out. Hup. Thanks, guys.
The cup of life. This is the one. Now is the time. Don't ever stop. We shouldn't know. Gotta be strong. We shouldn't know right from the top. And when you feel the heat, the world is at your feet.
Thanks, guys, for joining me tonight on South Bank. South Bank tonight, guys. That's right, South Bank, Victoria. Don't forget, next week, the show's going to be on with another special guest. What a story tonight. Please share this to all the kids to see what's happened with this guy's soccer journey, or football journey. Roger, football journey. Thanks, guys. Thank you next week. Here we go. Ali, Ali, Ali. Good. Thanks, guys. See you next week. Same time, same place, same bat station. I got all the block, buddy. What's his name next week? Batman. Thanks, guys. Good night, guys. Thank you.
Hi, guys. Harry Sunday here, letting you know that there's an apparel company that supports the game that you love. It's called There Is Only One Football.com, guys. They've got all sorts of stuff, from caps, T-shirts, water bottles, all sorts of accessories, even for your mobile phone, all that sporting stuff you can wear anywhere you want to wear it, guys. That's right. And don't forget the website it's on, thereisonlyonefootball.com.
There's only one football!